morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
You can use your outside voice just for today. Is that all right, teachers? Just for today, you can use your outside voice. Because I like interaction. I like loud noises. I like smiles. I like hands. If you want to jump out of your seat, say, oh, I got it. I got the answer. You can do that, too. But before I even do that, how many of you answered? And as you see, I didn't put my name up here because I'm not really concerned about that, but I do have a message for you guys today. Something that will inspire you, something that will encourage you, something hopefully that will change your life today for the better, for the rest of your life, that you'll be a better person and that you'll strive for greatness and you'll be able to leave a legacy, or I'll ask you that question later, okay? But I'm Manuel Howard, and class of 94, Radnor High School. Football was my game. Football was my thing. Basketball. I love this school. I love great teachers like Miss Reardon that I had, and many of the others that poured into me and helped me become the person that I am today. So once again, Manuel Howard, class of 94, Radnor football, Radnor basketball, homecoming king, a little bit of everything, but I just love this place. So it means a lot to me to be here today. This is my born day, by the way, as well, me and George Washington. So I thank God for that. But I want to say to you a few things. I'm going to ask a couple questions. How many of you answered all the questions on your paper? Put your hand up if you've answered all the questions on your paper. How many, if you've answered one, put your hand up. Okay? If you've answered two, keep your hand up. Okay, if you've answered three, put your hand up. That means you're a super scholar. If you've answered four, but we don't know if they're correct yet.
Yeah.
All right, so if you answered five, anyone, no one. Okay, and this happens. This test, these questions that I came up with, even the guy at Staples, when I got these copies, some of them copied yesterday, he looked at the question and said, I'm so sorry, I don't know any of them, because I asked him. He said, I feel bad. I don't know the answer to any of these. So do not feel bad. Even some of these I had to look at and say, wait a minute. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Or need to look at and say, make sure that that's right. So one thing you will do today is learn something. Is everybody okay with that?
Yeah?
Yeah? And then the next question I'm going to ask you, which I asked in the earlier class, and I'm going to walk around. I may even weave through here. I may jump over stuff. Don't mind me. If I say duck, just duck. All right? So the question I'm going to ask you, who am I and why am I here? Two-part question or two questions. Hand? Yes.
You are Reverend Manuel Bumper Howard.
Whoa, somebody read something.
Whoa.
Go ahead.
And you are here to educate us on Black History Month.
Good response. Great response. Anybody else? Add to the who am I, why I'm here. Those were actual facts, but I want just random stuff. Who am I, why am I here? Do I look funny? The other class told me I look funny. Yes.
You're Radnor class of 94 and you are homecoming king.
You listen well. This is a great class. You guys are full of life and energy and good ears. There's a whole lot of scholarship in here. Yes. Oh, that is the reason I'm here. Did anyone hear it? Say that louder.
You're here to change our lives.
Wait, stand up and say that.
He's here to change our lives.
Yes. Did anybody hear that? I'm here to do what?
Change our lives.
I'm here to do what?
Change our lives.
I'm here to do what?
Change our lives.
Like I said, your life will never be the same after you leave today. And mine won't either, because I get more from you than you'll probably get from me. Light bulb went off. Turn back, switch back on. I'm here today for two things, really. One, to share a little bit about African American history. Many of you know about Dr. King. Many of you know about Harriet Tubman. Many of you know about Frederick Douglass. Many of you know about these people that everybody know about. But I'm here today to share some things with you and people with you that many people don't know about. All right? So according to this test, Nobody really knows about these things except one person in here is a scholar. Is that true that only one person here is a scholar?
These aren't right.
I love it. I love the truth comes out. That's good. All right, African American history, a legacy of greatness. Somebody explain to me what legacy means. Yes, sir.
Legacy is the impact that somebody has on other people or on the world.
Okay, I like that answer. A few more answers, yes.
It's how someone's remembered by future generations.
Okay, someone who's remembered by future generations. Yes, good answers.
The lasting impression of a certain person or group of people on others throughout history.
Somebody got that off of Google. No? You just knew that? Wow, I'm impressed. That is a Webster's Dictionary definition. I wish I could spout that off that good. So thank you. Anybody else? Yes?
Pericles had a quote. He said, your legacy is not what is engraved in stone monuments, but what is woven into the lives of others.
We got to give him a hand. Can we give him a hand? We got to give him a hand. Wow. Pericles. Oh, my goodness. I came to the right school. Wait a minute. I graduated from here. Good place to be. And my simple definition is basically this. Passing something down of importance. I like to say of importance to the next generation or to the next person coming behind you or historically. Okay? Passing something down. Your grandparents, your parents, your aunts, your uncles, your big brothers, big sisters, they've passed things down to you. They've left a legacy within your generation. Positive things passed down that you will take with you for the rest of your life. All right, Black history is American history. How many believe that statement? Put your hand up if you believe that statement. Black history is American history. So why do few people know about Black history? It's a $1 million question. And there's really many, many answers. Anybody have an answer? Yes, sir.
Maybe because these elements of Black history that are on this paper now are sort of overshadowed in schools by MLK and other historical Black figures at that time.
I like that answer. Anybody else have another answer? Yes, ma'am. Excellent. Great answer. Anybody else? Yes.
You only spend a month a year on it?
A month, which is 4 weeks.
It is.
Out of 52 weeks in a year. That's not good, is it? Thank you for pointing that out, because that's very important. And when we talk a little bit later about Black history, where it started, how it started, and how, we'll find out. Okay, that's a very important piece you mentioned there. We'll move on. But Black history is American history. Don't ever let anyone tell you it's not, because it is. Who's this guy? Dr. Carter G. Woodson. Remember this, the father of Black history. Anybody know who this guy is? Have you ever heard him, seen him in the Wawa or anything? No, I haven't either. But this what? Began the celebration of Negro History Week. 1 week instead of a month. He chose the second week of February to honor the birthdays of Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. And I like to say me too, because my birthday's today. In 1976, the celebration was expanded to the entire month of February. But back to you with that 1 month or 4 weeks out of 52. I think we need to find a way to incorporate into the whole 52 weeks of all curriculums. But that's just my thought. How many of you knew that inoculation was introduced to America by a slave? No one had ever heard of a Black woman pilot in 1919. I refused to take no for an answer. And I'm here to tell you today that I'm only here today in life and and all of this because I refuse to take no for an answer. As young people and as scholars and as students and as people who are in the world, community, future community leaders, future business owners, you're going to have to, future scholars, authors, you're going to have to refuse to take no for an answer. Because oftentimes it doesn't matter what you know, which is sad sometimes in this world, but often it's who you know and who you're networked to, who you're connected to, who you're partnered with. You see what that says up there? Somebody read that out loud for me.
Gerald Lawson, this engineer and inventor is the reason why disc-based home video games exist.
What does brilliant look like? Besides me, what does brilliant look like? Somebody tell me. Yes.
Like glasses, clean suit, very put together.
Brilliant. That's a good description of professional, but not always brilliant. Because people who look brilliant can fool a lot of people. But anyway, somebody else. What does brilliant look like? Yes, sir. Excellent. I'm telling you, just look in the mirror every morning. Every morning, I'm here to encourage you, look in the mirror every morning. Each one of you is brilliant. Each one of you has greatness. Each one of you has the ability to do and be successful in spite of what people have said to you, in spite of what people have done to you. You have the ability, no matter what your background is, no matter who your parents are, no matter what neighborhood you came from, no matter what language you speak, you have the ability to be great. You have the ability to be brilliant. And this guy here, we don't know if he looks brilliant or not, but he's brilliant. Garrett Morgan. Garrett Morgan invented the gas mask and the traffic light. Did anybody know this? This guy, Thomas Jennings. Have you ever heard his name?
No.
But your parents get their clothes dry cleaned all the time, don't they?
Yeah.
And as I go through this quickly, many people don't know this. Parts of this was even new to me. Did anybody hear that during the presidential campaign or elections? This name, Madam C.J. Walker. Not Oprah Winfrey. Anybody know Oprah Winfrey? We all know Oprah. But this is Madam C.J. Walker back in the day. The first American, not just African American, American businesswoman to become a millionaire. If you have an idea, go for it. If you have a thought of an invention, start writing it down now in your journal. Because everything in life, there's stages and seasons. But if you're not prepared when you get to where you need to get and to the pinnacle of where you're supposed to be and where your purpose to be, you'll fall short. So I tell you today, be prepared and always be preparing, because the worst thing that can happen to you or anyone is to get an opportunity and you're not prepared for it. Did you know that spark plugs were invented by a black man named Edmund Berger? Jack Johnson, heavyweight champion, the first, and mostly they're all the first. You're going to see they're all the first. But he also invented the wrench. During World War II, Ford was the first major company to pay blacks the same wages. Ford, the black man invented all of these things that we use today, especially the fire extinguisher. In every hall, in every classroom, in every house, and everywhere. So major, legacy and greatness. Legacy and greatness. And real quick here, first black women to earn PhDs, Georgiana Simpson, Sadie T. Alexander, and Eva B. Dykes. First African American to play in an NBA regular season game. But there always has to be a first. There always has to be a charter. There always has to be an inaugural. There always has to be someone who's willing to start, willing to do something different, willing to think outside of the box, willing to dare to be different, because Most leaders are very peculiar. Most leaders don't do everything that the norm does. So don't be afraid to be a leader. For him, he was the only one assigned to do that role, President Barack Obama. Earlier, C.J. Madam Walk was the only one assigned to be the first businesswoman to be a millionaire. It was assigned specifically for them. And I encourage you to write down your goals. Write down your plans, because if you can't see them and write them and articulate them, it will be very difficult to meet them. But I'm telling you, if you write them down, if you begin to set a standard for yourself, and if you look at it daily, you will reach whatever goal that you set your mind to. Now we can get into the fun stuff. Who's that guy? This is me. This is my wife. My beautiful wife. This is my beautiful 6-year-old daughter, Zion. And this is my beautiful son, Marcus, who's 14. He has cerebral palsy. He's wheelchair bound, can't see, can't walk, can't talk, but has more joy than most adults that you'll ever meet. Family must always be first. Family must always be first. Remember that. If you don't hear anything else I'm saying to you today, family must always be first, even now. Family must always be first, because when the crowd goes away and when people leave the room, your family will always be there with you. I challenge each of you tonight to go home and write 3 things that you want to accomplish in the next year, 3 things you want to accomplish in the next 3 years, and 3 things you want to accomplish in the next 5 years. I challenge you to do that. It will focus you, it will challenge you, and it will channel you. Close your eyes all over this room right now. Everybody just take a minute to close your eyes and listen to what I'm about to say to you. Have you ever heard the voice of someone who was born to a 15-year-old mother? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who was placed in foster care at the age of 2? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who didn't love himself? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who did not trust anyone? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who hated their mother and father? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who was angry and full of rage? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who never felt good enough? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who wanted to throw in the towel on life? Have you ever heard the voice of someone who survived 3 major car accidents? Open your eyes. Look forward. That was my voice. I am that voice. It describes me and who I was. And that's why I'm here today, and I'll unpack that as we move forward now. But I just wanted you to hear me and feel me now. If I can be born to a 15-year-old mother placed in the foster care at the age of 2, then you can do anything. There's no perfect family with white picket fences. It all looks good, but oftentimes there's many challenges of life. You're special. No matter if no one's ever told you that before, you're loved. And you're set apart for greatness. I hated myself. I hated my parents because I didn't understand, but it was really the biggest blessing that they gave me away at the age of 2. My 15-year-old mother couldn't raise me. My 60-year-old father couldn't raise me. My grandparents couldn't raise me at the time. They had their own children, 6 or 7, I don't know how many, 4 or 5. They couldn't raise me. But it was the best thing that ever happened to me. And many of you know some of my nephews and my family, of my foster family, the Sidnor family, Coach Sidnor. That's my brother. Okay? And I was placed in that family at the age of 2. And it was the biggest blessing. Our father was the first, George Sidnor was the first African-American police detective in Radnor Township. 3 of my brothers, including Coach Sidnor, went to the NFL. I was blessed. Out of a bad situation came a great situation. I was able to have mentors. I was able to see and have a vision to see what the next level looked like. Hope was inspired in me in the midst of a bad situation. Some of you are in bad situations right now. Some because you may not have a plan. Some because you may not have a mentor. Some because you may not have a friend. But I'm here to tell you that in spite of all of that, get back up. Some of you right now, you're walking the halls and nobody knows the severity of what you're dealing with and you think about throwing in the towel. I tell you today, do not forfeit your purpose. Do not forfeit what God has for you. Do not forfeit your legacy that we talked about earlier. Because in 2005, and I share this now, this legacy, and my wife's pregnant and the baby, and we found out 3 weeks ago, so one more on the way, that legacy would have been forfeited. In 2005, it was one of the most difficult times of my life, and I share this with you because this is why I'm here. 2005, I had lost my fiance. Was not my wife. I was 4 years in a relationship. Okay, things went sour there. I had lost my job. I was teaching foster kids at the Presbyterian Children's Village right in Garrett Hill in Rosemont. I thought I had lost my mind when all that stuff took place. I had moved back into my parents' home as a grown man. I was ready to throw in the towel. I contemplated driving my car into the R5 train station in Rosemont. Many of y'all know where that is. Still there today. I spent 3 days in my parents' house. Didn't shower and didn't eat. Stayed in one room. You hear what I'm saying to you? And then I heard a voice, the loudest audible voice that I've ever heard. And the most profound question followed the voice. It said, what about the children? And that's why I'm here. From that day forward, when I got that loud audible voice, my life has never been the same. Everything began to change. Everything began to shift. I went from the dumps and the valley to being up, moving, on fire, and transformed. So I tell you today, never give up. Never give up. I don't care how bad it gets. I don't care if you feel all alone. You're never alone. Never give up. There's no reason why anyone in this room cannot be a successful person. Well, I thank you, my fellow Radnorites and Raiders. It was awesome to be here. I'm just so thankful I could be here on my born day. So thank you for having me. Thank you for being attentive. And I hope you learned something that will change your life. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.